What is up, guys? Chase Oliver here, bringing you my WWE Night of Champions 2014 preview and prediction show. Now, when it comes down to Night of Champions, definitely the WWE has not done a good job getting me excited for Night of Champions. They have not produced good episodes of Monday Night Raw to the point where I'm saying I can't wait for Night of Champions. I have to force myself to get excited for Night of Champions 2014, and that's bad. If I had to say, well, you know, at least this match could be good, or this match could surprise me. Like, I have to assume that the WWE is going to do good things at Night of Champions 2014. I can't enter this pay-per-view confident that I'm going to walk out of this pay-per-view and say, wow, what a show by the WWE. That's how I feel about Night of Champions 2014 this Sunday. So really, to be honest here, not really all that excited for the show. The card looks really good on paper. Definitely some matches will deliver inside the middle of the ring. But really, my excitement level, it's like, That's pretty much it. But anyways, let's get started in predicting Night of Champions 2014. So the random pay-per-view match of the night, Chris Jericho taking on Randall Keith Orton. Obviously, that's not the only thing Chris Jericho is going to be doing tonight. He's going to be on the Peep Show with Christian. As for Christian coming back, I don't care. Hope he doesn't get another concussion. That's all I really got to say. Really, to be honest, I just don't care if Christian's back or not, because yes, he's a good in-ring performer, but the dude can't stay healthy to save his life. So I don't really care what Christian is doing in the WWE at this point. But as for Jericho and Orton, will this be a good match? Yeah, give them 10 minutes. I'm pretty sure they can do a good job in the ring. Who do I think is going to win? You know, even though I want to confidently say I think Randy Orton is going to win, I really think they are going to surprise us as I have Jericho with the upset win, and then afterwards you have it where Randy Orton goes into IED mode and he gets all upset, and then we see the return of the punt. So that way they can make Randy Orton a little bit more vicious. So that way you have it where Chris Jericho beats Randy Orton in a good way, and then you don't have Randy Orton look too weak, because then he beats up Chris Jericho at the end of the day. Then you have it where you can bring back Jericho to maybe feud with Orton around WrestleMania time if you want to do so, or have Jericho and Orton do some filler stuff at Royal Rumble or Elimination Chamber. You know, a bunch more possibilities out there with Randy Orton and Chris Jericho if you have Jericho win and then Orton do like a post-match attack. So I'm going to predict Chris Jericho for the win here. Roman Reigns and Seth Rollins. We saw this match on Monday Night Raw, and it was a pretty good match. So I'm pretty sure they're going to do good at Night of Champions. really, to be honest here, I don't know why the WWE gave us a free pay-per-view match the night before Raw. Now they're building us up as the rematch. And, you know, I want to say they're going to have Seth Rollins win in a screwy way. But really, to be honest, I'm going to give Roman Reigns the DQ win here. Really, Roman Reigns right now, he's on fire in the WWE. The WWE is booking this guy like a monster. They're trying to keep him strong because we all know who he's going to face down the line. He's going to face the game, Triple H. And Triple H can't face bozos and losers. No, he has to face the strongest guy in the damn world. So really, to be honest, when it comes down to Roman Reigns and Seth Rollins, I expect the match to be pretty solid. I see Corporate Kane ruining this match near the end. And Roman Reigns wins by DQ. Rusev versus Mark Henry, USA versus Russia, baby. And let me just say this. This is the one feud that I felt the WWE has done a good job in getting me excited for on this pay-per-view. I felt the WWE, this is the one feud where I'm like, I didn't have to force myself to try to find a ways to like this matchup. They did a good job booking this feud and making me care about the two characters involved, minus that main event segment from Monday Night Raw this past week. But other than that, let me just say this. This match could surprise us. It could be a total stink fest. We will never know. You never know when it comes to Mark Henry. You know, he could go out there. He can be the healthy Mark Henry that we know that can put on a really good big man match. Or he could be kind of like the semi-injured Mark Henry that is a little bit too slow, can't put on a really good match. We all know what Rusev's going to do. He's going to do his kicks. He's going to do his accolade. You know what Rusev's all about by now if you watched him. I think a lot of people expect Rusev maybe to have a surprise loss here. I see him winning in a dominant way. Really, the only way I see Rusev losing anytime soon is if he gets forced into a feud with John Cena or, you know, around WrestleMania time when they want to have someone finally beat Rusev in a big way on a big show. Because if you're going to build him up like a monster, you either have him lose at a big show or you have him lose to someone like at a high caliber superstar like a John Cena or a Daniel Bryan or a Randy Orton. You get the idea. But I think Rusev is going to win this match at Night of Champions, and Mark Henry will be another American who failed to represent the USA with pride. The Usos taking on the Dust Twins for the WWE Tag Team titles. If you've been watching my videos for a while, you should already know my answer to this. The Usos are going to retain. Reason being, the WWE wants them to be a dominant tag team, so when the Ascension comes up to the main roster, they beat them. That's pretty much it. They want the Usos to look so dominant. We try to figure out who can beat these motherfuckers. Out comes the Ascension. Then they beat them, and we're supposed to be surprised and all that crap. So really, to be honest, that's what they're going to do here. If the Dust Twins do win, I'm going to question the WWE's logic, because why in the blue hell are you going to try to book the Ascension as a babyface tag team to take away from the heel tag team, the Dust Twins? That would be pretty fucking stupid. But hey, it is what it is at the end of the day. Dolph Ziggler versus The Miz for the Intercontinental Championship. This will definitely be a good match. Dolph and Miz have great chemistry with each other. They just know how to click. They've always put on really good matches when they've gone against each other. So I'm expecting a good one between these two. I wonder how much the stunt doubles are going to get involved in this match. I hope they don't get involved too much, because I just want to kind of focus on Miz and Ziggler's story and how they're going to wrap up The Miz and Ziggler's story. Really, to be honest, I don't think The Miz will win the belt back here. I really think the WWE is going to try, and I repeat, try to have a babyface IC champion for at least a little while. You know, at least try to make a babyface IC champion. It's been a while since we've had a really credible babyface IC champion, and Dolph Ziggler definitely fits that mold if the WWE wants to book him to be an entertaining character. So why not? Let's see what Ziggler does as a babyface IC champion. So I have Dolph Ziggler retaining the belt here at Night of Champions. Cesaro and Sheamus for the United States Championship. Man, didn't we see this at Payback, and so many people were hoping Cesaro wouldn't win the U.S. belt. They were hoping some way Sheamus would retain because they said Cesaro's above the U.S. belt. Now, all of a sudden, we fast forward like 4 months later, and people are begging for Cesaro to at least get something under his resume. Really, to be honest here, it doesn't matter who wins this match, because they're still going to be booked poorly. They have done such a poor job with the United States champion over the last few months. You know, I was really hopeful with this Sheamus feud. I was really hopeful once they got Sheamus with that U.S. belt, they were going to turn him heel right away, and he was going to be a great heel U.S. champion for us. But nope, he's been a boring babyface like he has been since 2012. And then Cesaro, you know, he's trying to play a heel, but the fans want to cheer him. He has a moveset that fits a babyface standard, but yet they want to make him a heel. The dynamics don't work here. Do I see a double turn happening at this pay-per-view? No, I don't see a double turn happening on this pay-per-view. That would take extra booking and sense by the WWE, which I don't think they have. So really, to be honest here, I have Cesaro winning, you know, just in a good way. He'll win in a cheap way, like a roll-up or something, become the United States champion, be irrelevant with that belt, while Sheamus, he goes off and tries to win the WWE heavyweight title against Brock Lesnar at like TLC or something. I don't know. I really think they want to get the belt off Sheamus because they want to try to move him back up in the main event scene. That's just my prediction on it all. So yeah, so Cesaro is going to become the United States champion and be as irrelevant as Sheamus was as US champion. When it comes to the Divas title match, at least the WWE has featured it a lot on TV. Has the segments been good? No. It hasn't gotten me excited for it, but at least they featured it well on TV. When it comes down to it, there's only two women that probably are going to win this match. AJ Lee's out of the equation, just because I don't think the WWE will give the belt to her just yet. Paige is either going to retain because they realize, hey, we gave her the belt for a reason. Let's see how she runs with it. Maybe we can get one more AJ Lee match, maybe a Naomi match. And we don't need a belt on Nikki Bella to make Nikki and Brie a big match anyway, so why put the belt on her? So you could see Paige retain for those reasons, or you could have Nikki Bella win the belt because it's like, hey, look, Nikki Bella is our number one diva heel, and let's face it, she is our number one diva heel. Paige, at this point, she's not even a heel. She's like this weird tweener character. You don't even know what Paige's character is, and you don't even know what AJ's character is at this point. So, you know, Nikki Bella, she is the number one diva heel at that point. She is one of the main stars on WWE Total Divas. That's pretty much it when it comes down to it. You know, she is Stephanie McMahon's chosen character. And not to mention, her and her sister are in this feud with Stephanie McMahon. And you would think Stephanie McMahon, she would want the feud she's a part of to be for the big Divas title. So, you know, really, to be honest, you could see why Nikki or Paige are going to be, you know, the Divas champion. For me personally, I see some shenanigans happening where Brie Bella does cost Nikki the Divas Championship. I see Paige walking out as the victor, pinning Nikki Bella, and then having a one more blow-off match with AJ Lee at Hell in a Cell. But you know what? There's someone on here, guys, that you all know and love. He wants to talk about why Nikki Bella winning at Night of Champions is best for business. Take it away, Chase Boliver.
Thank you for the kind introduction, Chase. Hello, everybody. Chase's alter ego here, Chase Boliver. And I am the number one believer in the YWC. Now, anyways, guys, you all know I'm a big Paige fan. I've been supporting Paige on Chase's channel since her debut in the WWE. And I told you people she would blossom into a beautiful flower. And look at her now. She's a beautiful flower that all of you love and are entertained by. Even though Paige is one of my favorite divas, let me just say this. I don't think she needs a divas title. She's already bigger than the belt itself. She's won it two times. Most divas wish they could hold the belt just once. So since she's already held it two times, she doesn't really need the belt anymore, people. She can just lose it here. You gotta give the belt to Nikki Bella. Why? Because Nikki and Brie has to be one of the top three feuds in the WWE. It's true. You know, I see so many people being negative about this feud, saying it's terrible, it's garbage, they suck at acting. It's like, really? This is a legit great feud. We have two actual sisters fighting. When do we ever get that in the WWE? I get it. A lot of you guys don't like the Bella Twins, but if somehow this was Paige versus AJ Lee, let's just say Paige and AJ Lee were somehow twin sisters. That'd be pretty cool, right? But let's just say if they were twin sisters somehow, okay? Let's just say they were twin sisters, and they did the same shit. Y'all would love this feud. Y'all would say this feud is awesome. But yet, since a lot of you guys just don't like the Bella Twins for whatever reason, y'all think this feud is bad. It isn't that bad. It's actually really good television. Growing up, Bella has been some of my favorite stuff. I've watched that on YouTube at least 500,000 times. Hell, I love Nikki and Bree's in-ring segment with Jerry freaking Springer. Isn't it cool? Jerry Springer took time out of his busy schedule to come to Monday Night Raw. That's freaking awesome. They're doing good stuff. You know, they're trying. They're really trying hard. I've been into this feud, and I really feel like it is time for the WWE to do something awesome with the Divas Division by giving the title to Nikki Bella. And that's not the real awesome part. The real awesome part is this. You have it where Nikki wins a belt. Brie comes out and challenges Nikki. After Nikki wins the Divas title, she comes out and challenges Nikki at Hell in a Cell. And then you build this up. You build this up. And then at Hell in a Cell, guess what happens, people? It's a swerve, baby! Because as before, Nikki and Brie are about to wrestle. Brie points up in the sky, and the Hell in a Cell lowers down as Nikki and Brie Bella will be the first ever Divas title match, Hell in a Cell! Think about that, people. How awesome is that? How much credible would the Divas division look? Right now, Nikki and Brie is the hot feud. Right now, they are the money feud. Right now, they are the best feud. You have to give the belt to Nikki Bella here, WWE. I'll be fine if Paige retains or AJ wins, because no matter who wins this match, it's going to be awesome. But if you have Nikki win, that's more money and dollar signs for you, WWE. And I want you to live forever. I don't like when people say they hope you die. I want you to live forever. So anyways, guys, that's all I'm going to say. Nikki versus Brie, Hell in a Cell, Divas title match, first time ever. It'll be flipping awesome. What do you guys think about that? Now, I'm done here, guys. Remember, everything that WWE does is awesome. All you have to do is believe!
Did y'all just hear Chase Boliver right now? Did he really just say that? Oh my god, I gotta control him sometimes. But anyways, let's talk about Brock Lesnar and John Cena, the WWE Heavyweight Title Match, the main event for Night of Champions. Really, to be honest, when it comes down to this matchup, I just don't really care for it. I haven't been interested in the build-up whatsoever. It's the same John Cena build that they've been doing with him for a long time against dominant heels. Oh, you gotta turn into the dark side, John, to beat this heel. And then John Cena's like, no, the light overcomes everything. Sane Nation, baby! So it's like, we all know Cena. He ain't gonna be angrier at Brock. But definitely, for sure, I think that this matchup will be booked in a way where both men look even. Because really, to be honest, guys, I know a lot of you guys love the Cena beatdown on Brock, the Cena beatdown that Brock Lesnar gave him at SummerSlam. Totally understand. We barely see John Cena get his ass kicked like that. But here's the thing. When it comes down to the Brock Lesnar character, you can't have him look too fucking powerful. And if he does that to Cena two pay-per-views in a row, you just gotta ask yourself, who is going to beat this dude? And really, if that's going to be the formula for Brock Lesnar matches down the line, where pretty much every match he faces off against someone, he just overpowers them and makes them look like bitches, I mean, you're going to hurt half of your damn roster doing that. And not only that, you're going to make Brock Lesnar look too damn strong. And not only that, every main event will just be a boring suplex fest. Seriously, man, I won't want to see that if that's how Brock Lesnar is going to be booked. I mean, we have seen it in the past where Brock Lesnar has gone even and needed help to beat certain superstars in the WWE. We have seen him lose to some of the top guys in the WWE already. It's not believable for Brock Lesnar to just keep on being fucking dominant. I don't care what anyone says about this. Oh, well, Chase, you know, like they said in that interview, he's clear of his dying tuberculitis. He's no longer sick. So what, man? You still have to make it an even fight so that way Brock Lesnar doesn't look like he's too damn powerful. You make him too damn powerful, guess what, people? Roman Reigns will have to be booked just like Brock Lesnar to even beat the motherfucker if they go to WrestleMania. So really, to be honest, when it comes down to it, I expect a much more even matchup between Cena and Lesnar, a much better matchup than the one they had at SummerSlam, but Brock Lesnar will retain and walk out as the WWE Heavyweight Champion of the World. I hope they do have an even matchup between Cena and Lesnar, because if Cena gets beaten down again by Brock with all those damn suplexes, I don't know what the fuck the WWE is going to do with Brock Lesnar, and they might as well just have made Brock Lesnar too much of a beast. But hey, we all have to wait and see what happens. Who do you guys got in Lesnar versus Cena? Comment that down below. When it comes down to Night of Champions 2014, it's like I said in the beginning of my video, you know, this show has the potential to deliver very well. You know, on paper, it looks like a good freaking show. The WWE can make a complete 180 with their current product now by producing a really good Night of Champions pay-per-view event. They just have to execute well. Surprise us a little bit more on this pay-per-view. Give us good booking decisions. Make us say, wow, what a surprise show Night of Champions 2014 is. Because it can be. Look at the card on paper, guys. This has potential to be a good show, but the WWE has to execute. That is the bottom line simple truth. You can make any show look good on paper, but if it doesn't deliver, the show isn't good. You get what I'm saying? It's like, you know, the brand names. You know, you could be drinking a Coca-Cola, but just because it says Coca-Cola on it, you know, doesn't mean it's that the actual real shit. It could be some fake shit that you bought at Kmart. So that's just the bottom line. So hopefully that this show delivers. This show does deliver because I want it to deliver. I want a 180. I want to watch some good WWE TV again. So we don't have to wait and see for Night of Champions 2014. But anyways, guys, in the comment section down below, comment anything Night of Champions 2014. What are your predictions? What match are you looking forward to? How are you going to be watching Night of Champions? Are you going to watch it on the WWE Network? Or are you streaming this show? I want to know everything in the comment section down below. Make sure you guys give this video a big old thumbs up. Subscribe if you haven't already. Follow me on Twitter at ChaseOliver68. And check out my website, chillingwithchase.com. I am out of here. I hope you guys enjoy your day. Peace.